to introduce the first speaker. He is a history professor at Summer State University, where he also sits as the faculty regent in the SSU Board of Regents. He finished AB Social Science, major in political science from UP Tacloban College, and Master of Arts in Teaching Social Sciences from Leyte Normal University. He is presently pursuing a PhD in Social Science at Silliman University. He is the Director of Arts and Cultural Heritage Office and the concurrent head of the Summer State University Museum and Archives in Catbalogan City. He is a member of the Philippine National Historical Society and was the local convener of the Philippine National Historical Society's 39th National Conference on Local and National History, locally hosted by Summer State University in 2018. To present his topic titled, Babae Nga Bisaya, the Bisayan Woman According to Father Alsina, let us give a warm round of applause for Mr. Jonil C. Bahado.
Maupay nga aga ha aton nga tanan. Pag humalatag ko hing katalahuran han chair han Philippine National Historical Commission Sir Ricky Jose nganan sugod man ang president han University of Eastern Philippines Dr. Ultra han aton mga distinguished guests, mga kasangkayan, maupay nga aga ha aton nga tanan. An uluhan han akon igpresentar yan nga aga in Babae Nga Bisaya or the Bisayan Woman According to Alsina. Father Alsina, whose 350th death anniversary we celebrated yesterday, and of course this conference is commemorated for, is a very important figure. In the history of Eastern Visayas in particular, and the development of Philippine history in general. His monumental work, known in the academic community, this is an artistic rendition of the photo of Father Alsina, made by an artist from Borongan. I had the liberty to use this, Mr. Mel Amasa, through the initiative of the city government of Borongan. His monumental work in the is known in the academic community, Historia de las Islas y Indios de Visayas, which he wrote in the duration of his more than 30 years of mission in Samar and Leyte area, although he spent 42 years in the Philippines until his death in Manila, where he was also buried, is perhaps the most comprehensive history of any region in the country that details the life and times of the 17th century Philippines. The book, which he commenced writing formally in Palapag, Northern Samar, although the drafts or earlier drafts were written in Borongan in Eastern Samar, his first official assignment when he arrived to the Philippines as a young priest from Spain, details important events which Father Alsina personally witnessed and consequently had some personal notes. He completed his final draft in Catbalogan, his last assignment in Samar. While the title of this presentation seems big in scope, the objectives are actually narrowed to take a glimpse through some depictions of Bisayan women by Father Alsina in his Historia. In particular, the twofold objective will try to map how Father Alsina describes Samarnon women during his times and what is the status of Bisayan women during this period, thereby locating the role and status of women in the 17th century Samar society. The silent and invisible place of the Bisayan women in scholarly literatures and the study of pre-colonial Philippine society, or even the societies at the onset of Spanish colonial rule, is said to be a challenge to scholars because of scant and meager available resources. Other scholars point out that aside from this virtual scarcity of resources, Some readings have been mediated and filtered by the compiler or recorder, almost always a foreigner viewing a strange event or ritual of observing local conditions in passing what they appear may appear unimportant. These are the silences and invisibilities in the resources written by foreigners accordingly. Additionally, scholars suggest that witnessing is recorded in the foreigner's language, which is bound by its own culture, categories, and meanings, appear to be describing the indigenous subject who may actually manage to remain unseen and unheard. While there are a lot of intended omissions in the writing of Father Alsina's Historia, as he would dismiss as unimportant, and to shorten the narrative of his report, the Historia de las Islas y Indios de Visayas still is a rich source of information relative to the status and role of women in a 17th century Samar. What is needed is the localization and contextualization of the narratives, or in effect, creating an appropriated meaning which is true to our context of heritage and culture. That's why it was Father Alsina that I have learned on how we greet our visitors. So, haniya panahon ang pag-greet nato ng mga visitors, maupay nga adlaw, maupay nga pag-abot, mga dumuruong. It's because of the context that the main or the means of transportation before was through the waters. So, ang pag malatag hing katalhuran ng mga bisita, diri man bisita ang tawag, because it's a Spanish word, mga dumuruong. So, in the proper context. Maanyag nga Bisaya, mahusay nga babay. One of the interesting descriptions of a Bisaya woman by Alsina was found in the literary art forms of early Samarnons. Alsina mentioned at least 7 literary art forms, and let me introduce these 7, all of which except Siday have been virtually lost in the present literary landscape of Eastern Visayan literature. The first one is what he called ambahan. Ambahan was the simplest poetic form, says Alsina. It was usually performed in fiestas and other gatherings of entertainment. Next is also lost what we call the bikal. It's another poetic form which was a verse performed by either 2 men or 2 women. This art form usually lasts for not less than 2 hours. Without a pause. So, duha ka oras. This is akin to durugas or kulitog, which the writer Cassiano Trinchera is known for. This researcher argued that this is also an earlier form of what the Tagalogs call balagtasan, but in different form. Bikal was a satirical form which tirades physical and moral faults of the opponent. This will draw laughter and much delight to the audience, which would be taking sides with applause and noisy mirth. Then we have balak. Orihuntan siday. Balak was usually performed. By a man and a woman of the theme about love. This is accompanied by musical instruments. Kuryape and kurlong, it is presumably the earlier form of smiling, as we know it today. I want to point out that the transition of the name from balak to smiling is another gap worthy of scholarly scrutiny. There is only one mention of balak changing its nomenclature to amoracion during Spanish period, but as far as this researcher is concerned, there is no concrete evidence that this was indeed called amoral or amoracion by the Spaniards. So when I was doing a field research in Eastern Samar, in the hinterlands of Eastern Samar, the old folks called the Kanta Historia nga baton-baton as baris-barisay. Next is the haya or kanugon or panganugon. Other scholars classify haya and kanugon into one as mourning dirges. However, I would like to argue that haya was different from kanugon. While the two were specifically performed during the mourning of the deceased loved ones of our earlier Samarnons, Haya also means to cry, paghaya, was intentionally categorized differently by Alcina because Haya was a poetic form performed to praise the good deeds of the deceased, while the kanugon or the panganugon was chanted to invoke the diwatas in order to guide the deceased. So, diri pwede basta-basta himuon ang kanugon hinbisan hinula. Another literary form is called awit, or the sailing poems or songs performed during sea travels. Considering that Samarnons were natural-born seafarers and excellent sea navigators, literature was also present in this undertaking. Men would usually row their sea vessel and perform awit. Both men and women were known to join fish-catching activities, so it is presumed that pag-awit was also performed by women. Ancient Samarnons would recite poem or chant while doing their chores, or according to Alcina, even just walking home from the woods, planting rice, performing house chores, and traveling at sea. While this form has been lost to oblivion, one can relate awit to the selling songs which is popular until the 90s in the markets of Leyte. And lastly is the siday. Siday today is the generic term for waray poem or waray poetry. But actually, according to Father Alcina, siday is the most complicated literary art form by the Samarnons. In essence, this is the only one left among the literary traditions recorded by Alcina in the 1600s. During Alcina's time, however, as what I have mentioned, it was the most difficult to perform of all the types of literary art forms, with the usual theme to praise others, to chant about the heroic exploits of their ancestors, or good qualities of a woman or a courageous man. It is for this purpose that I mentioned the literary art forms, because aside from the points that I have argued earlier, it is in our literature that Father Alcina first mentioned on how the beauty of the Visayan woman was highlighted. Although he wrote it in Spanish, the translated form roughly goes this way. Mata nga daw patubarani, naguuripon sin kadam-an. Ugsa kapag siplat, ug usa kapag siplat imugin bibihag an kapidan. Labaw san luran san kanan banyaga sa sakyan. So in transliteration, pwede ini ihimuon nga couple nga baganayakan. Daw batubarani an imo kaanyag. Lupig pahan pirata kasing-kasing ko imo binihag. So to that effect. So the translation is the English version was written by or translated by Petronilo Bendaroy, while the Waray version was written by Jose Cinco Gomez of Calpayog. So this is how the beauty of a Bisaya was described through a siday or through this literary art form. The pre-colonial Bisaya nga babayi and the beauty of the pre-colonial Bisayan women was enshrined in Father Alcina's discussion of the binukot. It is perhaps Father Alcina who made us see how a principalia binukot looks like in ancient times through this photo, part of the historia. So kung mahusay, kamo na lait pag-judge. In his narratives, it can be Father Alcina gives a description of the physical characteristics of the binukot, whom he described to be fairer in complexion, and even more especially the principalas, who were of white features and as fair as the Spanish women. Ang iba nga ni kuno mas mabusag pa kontrahan mga babaeng Espanyol. In his narratives, it can be alluded that beauty was part of the cultural heritage of the women in the 17th century summer societies. Aside from excessive display of gold ornament, so in fact we have specific names of our Sabit or Arios, no? As far may da tinatawag nga panika, pamarang and pinarugmok. Because the pamarang was usually used or worn by women to avoid barang. That's why it's called pamarang. Well, in their belief, no? Then we also have like the chain called kamagi. They use the use of perfume from organic sources and to a more elaborate fashion, such as the presence of gold fillings or the gold pegs in the teeth of women. So normally, triangular pattern of gold fillings in the teeth are designs, no, for women. So kung triangular nga ni ko, no, usually babae iton nga design. So this one, displayed in one of our Philippine museums in the country, presumably is of a woman's skull. This is called, in our local language, pagbansil. Yes, pagbansil. These were a clear manifestation that women have to undergo sophisticated processes for and in the name of beauty, such as another practice, the pagpatik. According to Father Alcina, pagpatik or tattoo, the practice of tattooing, while it is not peculiar in Eastern Visayas, kay haros tanan habugos nga Pilipinas na mamag-tattoo, but it was the people from Samar and Leyte area who were most heavily tattooed. That's why they call, the Spaniards call us the Islas de los Pintados, the island of the painted people. Egalitarianism in early Visayan society. Reading through the historia of Father Alcina, one can surmise the state and role of women in the 17th century Samar society. While Father Alcina keeps on mentioning Visayan women doing needlework, weaving a mat, leading the church activities later on, one can also conjecture that women do the work in as much as the men does. Nagbabayo or pounding rice, nagigiok, nagpipilipig, he mentioned that, or flattening rice for Rice Krispies. In fact, Father Alcina mentions that women in Samar show great expertise in farming. While it was true that Visayan men hunt and the women gather, it can be construed that the work was complementary and was never about gender appropriation of chores. One of the most interesting facets of an egalitarian state of early Visayan societies could be found in the mythology of creation of Samarnons. While it has been popularized as a Tagalog story, si Malakas at si Maganda, the story of siyapa nga babae nga lalaki, or the first woman and the first man, coming out from a big bamboo nut, was originally a Visayan mythology of creation. Sociologists and anthropologists view this as a superior creation mythology, for it is an egalitarian orientation on how man and woman came to life together, not one after the other, common in the patriarchal Western mythologies, and according to my sociology professor in UP, even the Bible. Interestingly, there are other versions of the story from different areas in Samar. One is, instead of the bamboo, the first woman and the first man came out from a pair of coconut. This is even more superior because it entails independence of women from its counterpart sex. If only for egalitarianism, Father Alcina's historia gives us a great deal of how gender equality is, consciously or not, part of the norm of the Samarnan society as early as 1600s. His historia narrates how effeminate males called asog or bayot are revered and respected in the Visayan society. We are the first, or it, at least the records would show, being friendly to bayots, because our bayots in Samar were cross-dressers, and they can be assistants to the Babaylan, and they live the modo de vida or the way of life that of their choice. So tayo po ang pinaka-friendly sa mga bayot, no, as far as Father Alcina is concerned. Even in the mystical and mythical babae image, for example, this one is a drawing from Father Alcina showing the male and female kataw or mermaid, merman, which he described. The power of a woman as a figure in the 17th century Visayan society is evident in the system of beliefs among Samarnons during this period. For example, Alcina mentions that some of his contemporary scholars during his time, and even through his narrations or through the narrations of the natives during his interviews, they believed that Laon, the ancient god, which the Mount Canlaon is named after in Negros, the Visayan counterpart of Bathala of the Tagalogs, is actually a woman. But of course, Father Alcina later on mentioned that he thinks that Laon and Makapatag was just the same. Alcina also mentioned that the understanding of the Samarnons of the earthquake phenomenon called Linog is caused by Adiwata's shaking of her unusually large breasts. Even the Diwata of Forest named Banwaanon, also called Diyawa, is believed to be a beautiful Diwata offered by the first hunted boar by the wild boar hunters, hence the term Pagyawa. So that's why in my classes in summer studies, because I'm also the head of Summer State University Museum and Archives, and it was my initiative that a course called Summer Studies be offered at SSU. So we are offering a subject called Summer Studies. This is a required subject for social studies majors. I take it as a joke that Tiawa was a Diwata, no? But they were demonized when the Spaniards came. So Diyawa means a beautiful babaylan perhaps, or a deity. So do not be offended when somebody tells you ngayawa ka. It means you are beautiful woman or deity. So when somebody tells you yawa ka, reply, thank you very much. Interestingly, the Kanyawa Mountain, believed to be the domain of the Diwata Iyawa, is located at the middle of the forest in between the towns of Maslog and Hipapad in eastern Samar and Matuginaw in the west. There is also a sitio called Iyawa nearby the mountain. Ayan. Iyawa, Mount Kanyawa. Upon the evangelization of Spanish missionaries, the performance of the Pagyawa was tagged as an evil act. Hence, Yawa practically became synonymous to evil. One of the most shocking sights of the Spaniards at the beginning of their mission was the active role of the women priestesses called Babaylan in the faith and belief system of the Samarnons. The mystical role of the Bailan or Babailan, I'm saying this Babailan because I noticed that in the spelling of Father Alcina's manuscripts, it's spelled as Bailan. And I realized that when I was also doing field work in Paranas, they pronounce the word Babailan, not Babailan. So that's why I intend to pronounce it also as Babailan. And I was shocked because when I was doing a research of a certain hero personality, si Bruna Fabrigar in the hinterlands of Paranas, they keep on mentioning that the old folks were mentioning that she was a Babailan, not Babailan. So Bailan or Ba, in the text of Father Alcina, it's Bailana. or Babaylan was centered on the rituals it performs for the religious activities of the pre-colonial society. If the Dato was in charge of the government affairs of the community, the Babaylan governs the religious aspects, making the roles independent but co-equal. So the Bisayan woman was indeed an important figure that holds a special function in the role and role in the 17th century Samar. Father Alsina was blunt in saying that Samarnon women were more pious and prayerful than the Spanish women. In fact, he mentioned that the greatest attractiveness or beauty of Samarnon women is to be just a woman. Although there were vices and bad habits observed by Father Alsina for both men and women in Samar, but in the course of his narratives, more praises were recorded to the Bisayan women, especially on their religiosity, notwithstanding the bias of Father Alsina being a man of Kasak. Father Alsina knows that during masses, women were usually more in attendance than men. But generally, Bisayan women are more religious than those in Spain and even the insular women in the country. Father Alsina, on his 38th year with the Bisayans, mentioned that the Bisayan women, as they were already ordained in social graces, do not lag to Spanish women in the manner of dressing, in physical bearing, and personal adornment. Whether Father Alsina was describing it in exaggeration, he mentioned that Bisayan women are more modest in virtue than the Spanish women, whom he describes as more coquettish and lascivious, and the attraction to sex is much more stronger than anywhere else in the world. Mga oragon ko ng mga Espanyola. And mga waray, oragon pero sakto la. Towards the end of my presentation, situating Alsina's role in Philippine local history is indeed, Father Francisco Ignacio Alsina's historia is indeed wealthy of information which, in the words of Father Kobach, is almost exhaustive of materials that are priceless of value for areas in anthropology, ethnography, and historical interest, and in the cultural perspectives. Alsina's works provide scholars an interesting material for its voluminous content with great elaboration, which is fundamental for whatever approximation to the historical knowledge on the Bisayan history and culture. This paper is a preliminary attempt to locate the role of women from the narratives written in the book of Father Alsina. While the scope is limited, the narratives in the historia of Father Alsina shed lights to some insights of the egalitarian state of the Samarnon communities in the 1600s by reading his historia along varied areas from literary art forms to his daily mission reports. However, there is still the necessity to reread the sources as well as the events and see other perspectives and frameworks that can comprehensively explain, that could challenge existing ones about our conception of our indigenous society, their relations and their concepts of power, women, and our ethos as a people. A multidisciplinary approach will be necessary to determine the extent of the role of Father Alsina in the cultural and historical landscape of Samar in particular and the Philippines in general. But as it is, the role of Father Alsina cannot be lesser than a gran defensor de los indios, or the great defender of the Bisayans, as he is aptly described by his contemporaries. Gracias and requestcat in pace, Francisco Ignacio Alsina. Damo nga salamat nga naupay nga adlaw ha aton na tanan.